So apparently there are a lot of people asking a lot of questions about mushrooms, and since you're nice enough to be watching this channel, I Googled them all for you so you don't have to. In this video, we're gonna be going over the most commonly Googled questions about mushrooms, the who, why, what, when, where, and maybe a little bit more about the Fifth Kingdom. How do mushrooms reproduce? So this is something called the mushroom life cycle, and it's actually pretty interesting. I might do a whole video on this topic, but basically the idea is mushrooms reproduce in a perfect cycle, right? It all starts with the spore. The spore eventually spits out a little hyphae, and that hyphae meets another hyphae. Those two hyphae come together. That turns into mycelium. The mycelium grows. Eventually the mycelium will turn into a little knot, which will turn into a primordia, which turns into a fruiting body, grows into a big, beautiful mushroom, which produces spores, and the whole cycle starts again. So I mean, basically all mushrooms follow this mushroom life cycle. Some get a little more complicated, like chaga's got a pretty complicated life cycle, and some are a lot less complicated, like an oyster mushroom. The thing that's most interesting actually about mushrooms and how they reproduce is just how many spores they reproduce. Because when you're cultivating mushrooms, you know, it can actually be kind of difficult to produce them, but it happens in nature's, you know, all by itself. And the reason it's able to happen in nature is because mushrooms produce billions and billions of spores, and you might not see them everywhere, you might not think that they're everywhere, but basically, every breath you take, you're breathing in some spores. They're absolutely everywhere, and it's just a total shotgun approach to grow mushrooms. Next question is, how do mushrooms affect the brain? And I'm assuming this might be talking about psilocybin mushrooms, which is kind of interesting, and we can talk about that. I mean, psilocybin mushrooms contain something called psilocybin, which turns into psilocin, which basically mimics serotonin, which is kind of like the operating system of your brain. So psilocin, when it mimics serotonin in your brain, is one of the reasons why people have all these effects from psilocybin-containing mushrooms. But there's lots of other ways that mushrooms can affect your brain, right? There's mushrooms like lion's mane that might help to produce nerve growth factor, which is something that helps, you know, protect and help even grow new nerves and neurons, which are located in your brain. So a lot of people use mushrooms like lion's mane for cognitive health. And there's also things like cordyceps that infect the brains of caterpillars and burst fruiting bodies through their heads. So, I mean, mushrooms can affect your brain in all different ways, but I assume that Googled question is probably talking about psilocybin mushrooms or
magic mushrooms.
But yeah, they can definitely have an effect on your brain. How do mushrooms affect trees? I'm guessing that's talking about different mycorrhizal relationships between mushrooms and trees. So there are some mushrooms that can just grow on dead matter. They don't need any living things whatsoever, but there's other mushrooms that use what's called mycorrhizal relationships. And this is basically a symbiotic relationship between the mushroom's mycelium and the tree. And they kind of have this symbiotic relationship. It's kind of capitalist really, where the mushroom provides moisture to the tree and the tree provides nutrients to the mycelium. It's kind of this thing that goes back and forth, and they really do work together. Some mushrooms are obviously parasitic to trees. So talk about honey mushrooms or chaga, for example, which is actually something that will kill a healthy tree. Sometimes it's more of a mutual relationship where they kind of benefit each other. So mushrooms can affect trees in all sorts of different ways. How can mushrooms save the world? Okay, so it didn't show up. I think the reason why this is a Google question is because of a TED talk that Paul Stamets did called 6 Ways Mushrooms Can Save the World, where he talks about all these different ways, like mushrooms cleaning up oil spills, mushrooms saving the bees, mushrooms for health, and all this kind of stuff. So that's probably why that question is asked. But it's a good question, because there's a lot of things that mushrooms are going to be able to do that people are studying right now. Things such as cleaning up oil spills, mushroom materials, mushrooms as a meat replacement, mushrooms used for mycoremediation and soil remediation, mushroom used in, you know, agriculture to help plants grow better, and obviously mushrooms for physical and mental health. So if there is anything that's going to be saving the world over the next little while, it might just be mushrooms, so it's a totally reasonable question to ask. How mushrooms communicate. Now, this is actually pretty interesting. One of the things I like to think about mushrooms in the woods, if you're ever walking through the woods and you peel back a piece of moss, underneath it, you'll see a layer of mycelium, and mushrooms almost have this underground internet network. Some people call it like the original network. Other authors have called it the wood wide web instead of the world wide web. But mushrooms can communicate not only with themselves, but with other things through a network of mycelium. And I don't know exactly the mechanism that's used here, if it's like electrical impulses or if it's actually just different compounds going back and forth between the mycelium, but mushrooms actually can communicate on a wide scale using this mycelial network, which is a super cool topic. And again, this is something that is pretty deep and we should definitely go into in another video, but yeah, mushrooms communicating through mycelium is a pretty cool concept. Now we're on to the who's. So who invented mushrooms? I don't know. I don't know who invented mushrooms, because that doesn't really make sense. Mushrooms kind of invented themselves. You know, they've been around for a really long time. I don't know the exact archaeology of it, but some people think, you know, mushrooms are some of these huge huge structures tens of thousands, if not millions of years ago, some of the first things to inhabit the earth. The thing that's cool about mycology is that it is a pretty new science, right? And it's one of these citizen sciences where, like, no matter what you're doing, you can probably contribute a little bit to the world of mushrooms. So who knows, maybe you can come up with something, and then someday when somebody Googles who invented mushrooms, you'll come up. Who discovered mushrooms are edible? And that's a really good question, actually, because yeah, that's interesting to think who would have the guts to first eat a mushroom if they didn't know what the edibility is. And there's a saying that's kind of corny in the mycological community, but it's something along the lines of, there are old mushroom hunters and there are bold mushroom hunters, but there are no old and bold mushroom hunters, because eventually if you're just tasting random mushrooms all over the place, you're gonna run into a poisonous one, because there are lots of poisonous ones, some deadly poisonous mushrooms, but there are lots of delicious gourmet edible mushrooms obviously as well. So somebody had to figure that out. Definitely wasn't me. It's not gonna be me in the future. I don't know who's doing that, but there's some brave people out there eating mushrooms. Don't recommend you try that at home. Obviously some mushrooms are safer than others, but yeah, at some point somebody had to be the first one to give it a go. Why do mushrooms grow on my lawn? I mean, mushrooms grow in all sorts of different places, and mushrooms inhabit all sorts of different environments and habitats on Earth. So the fact that mushrooms grow on your lawn is pretty reasonable. Of course, not all species will grow on your lawn. There's some very specific grass-loving or meadow-loving mushrooms. Some ones are even common ones, like the meadow mushroom, which is similar to the button mushroom, or the shaggy mane, which often grows on lawns. There's sometimes some not so wonderful mushrooms that grow on lawns that you wouldn't want to eat, but yeah, it's pretty common for mushrooms to grow on front lawns. Why do mushrooms taste so bad? I disagree. Next question. Why do mushrooms grow in circles? That's a really good question, actually. And you might have seen this, like, fairy rings of different mushrooms, and lots of different mushroom species do this, actually, where they will grow in kind of a perfect circle, and no, it's not, you know, a little fairy that's going and planting them all in a circle. The reason why it does that is because underneath the ground is the mycelial network, and mycelium will quite often grow in a circle, and right at the leading edge of that mycelium is where the mushrooms will fruit. So that's why you see these perfect circles of mushrooms. And again, lots of species do this, but it's a totally common thing, and it's actually pretty cool to see. Where do mushrooms come from? This is actually a really good question, and the reason I wanted to answer this one is because there's this really cool concept called panspermia, and it's the idea that mushrooms might have come from space. So people have discovered that some spores can actually survive in space, and spores can survive in really insanely dangerous environments such as space. So the idea that mushrooms perhaps came from a comet or some asteroid that hit the Earth. I mean, mushrooms just seem so incredibly distinct from all the other life on this Earth that it's not the craziest thought to think that they could have come from space. Where do mushrooms get their energy? This is kind of an interesting question. You know how plants take energy from the sun and they use chlorophyll and they do that thing that I can't think of it is right now, but anyways, what the f- is it called? Photosynthesis. They use photosynthesis to produce energy. Mushrooms don't use photosynthesis. In fact, they get their energy from digesting things like wood and digesting things like compost. And they actually use a digestive system, unlike humans that digest stuff on the inside of our bodies, right? Mycelium puts out compounds and digests stuff on the outside of it and then brings those nutrients in. So mushrooms actually get their energy from digesting things like wood and other materials that can be broken up by the mushroom mycelium. Where do mushrooms grow best? That obviously depends on the type of mushroom, whether it's growing in the wild, whether it's being cultivated. But you know, sometimes you can be really surprised, right? I mean, some mushrooms need a lot of light and need a lot of heat, like reishi or other tropical species of mushrooms. And some mushrooms are the complete opposite, right? They need a lot of cooler temperatures. You know, mushrooms are like other plants where they can grow in all sorts of different environments. But mushrooms in particular can grow on all sorts of different substrates, and all sorts of different temperatures all over the place. But typically, if you were to really sum it up, where do mushrooms grow best? They want humidity, and they want fresh air, and they want reasonable temperature, and that's where you're gonna find mushrooms. If you're hunting mushrooms in the wild, you're more likely to find them in the Pacific Northwest, in the rainforest, than you would find them in the desert of Arizona, but you will definitely find mushrooms in both of those places either way. Where are mushrooms decriminalized? Now, I'm not a legal expert, obviously, but this is interesting, and I can see why people are Googling this, because this seems to be something that is happening all over the place. So there's certain states, and I guess certain cities, like Denver and places in Oregon. Again, I don't know the specifics on all of this. Psilocybin mushrooms in particular, I mean, button mushrooms, I think, are decriminalized everywhere. I'm assuming this question is talking about psilocybin mushrooms. But yeah, there's a lot of cities that are decriminalizing them, or at least making them the lowest priority of law enforcement. I think Detroit was another recent one, and again, Denver and Oregon, and there's a spattering of them all among the United States, and I think this is something that's gonna keep happening. When do mushrooms go bad? I mean, again, obviously it depends on the mushroom, but there is some interesting things going on on in mushroom cultivation, there was somebody who figured out that you can edit a gene in the white button mushroom and make it last a lot longer. Basically, the mushroom has a gene in it that causes it to brown relatively quickly when it's bruised or when it's damaged or after just sitting in the fridge for a while. And they used some CRISPR gene editing technology to basically snip that gene out and make it so the mushroom didn't brown as fast. Typically, a couple weeks in the fridge and then you don't want to use your mushrooms anymore. When do mushrooms release spores? So again, mushroom fruiting bodies produce spores. Spores are part of the mushroom life cycle that kind of help this virtuous cycle where their spores turn into mycelium, which turns into a fruiting body. So right at the end of the mushroom life cycle, or the beginning of the mushroom's life cycle, depending on when you want to define it, is when mushrooms release spores. You can often see this in the wild. You know, if you see mushrooms, quite typically they'll grow and then the cap will just kind of barely turn up, and that's when the spores will come out, and it's billions of spores. Mushrooms release way more spores than you'd ever think. And you know, even sometimes when you're cultivating mushrooms like reishi, you can see them releasing spores and it will settle down on top of the reishi fruiting body. What mushrooms are poisonous? I wish there was an easy answer for this. Wouldn't it be great if you could just say, what mushrooms are poisonous? And it's like, any mushroom that's purple or any mushroom that's red or whatever, but that is just not true. There's no one simple answer to say whether or not a mushroom is poisonous. So it's kind of impossible to answer that question on a broad scale, but if you do want to ask that question, it's best to ask like your local mycological society or someone who knows about mushroom hunting in your particular area, and they can likely tell you what mushrooms are poisonous and which ones you might want to avoid in your specific situation. What mushrooms are toxic to dogs? That is a good question, actually. In general, specifically with medicinal mushrooms, dogs react really well to them. So there is mushroom supplements for dogs. A lot of people give, like for example, turkey tail or other properly prepared medicinal mushrooms to their dogs, and they can actually benefit from that a lot. But I guess if your dog is randomly eating mushrooms off the ground or randomly eating mushrooms off of a log, yeah, there's a potential that your dog could get sick. There is a really great group on Facebook. I don't know the exact name, hopefully we'll put it in this video somewhere, but if you do find that your dog has maybe eaten a mushroom and you're unsure, you can post it on that group, and then a bunch of really awesome mycologists and people will dig into it and tell you whether or not it's something you can worry about. But in general, it's kind of the same as for humans. Some mushrooms are bad, some mushrooms aren't. It really depends. So the two final questions, I'm gonna kind of put them together, commonly asked are, can mushrooms kill you, and are mushrooms good for you? Which are obviously two completely different things. And the answer is yes to both of them, which is kind of interesting, right? Yes, some mushrooms can kill you. There are deadly poisonous mushrooms. In general, it's not something to be super concerned about, and I think it's caused a lot of mycophobia or fear of mushrooms that isn't necessarily warranted, because most mushrooms won't kill you. Some mushrooms can kill you, most mushrooms won't. And the second question is, are mushrooms good for you? Absolutely yes. I believe mushrooms are nature's most powerful superfood. There's lots of amazing medicinal mushrooms like reishi and turkey tail and chaga and lion's mane and cordyceps, maitake, enoki. Lots of mushrooms that are really, really good for you and have a lot of amazing and powerful compounds that can really help your body do all sorts of different things. So yes, mushrooms are really good for you. We have done a lot of in-depth videos on certain medicinal mushrooms if you want to go check those out on our channel. Otherwise, you can check our website as well. We've done a lot of different guides on all the different medicinal mushrooms. But yeah, I believe mushrooms are maybe the best thing for you. So there you have it. There's the most Googled mushroom questions. I had fun going through all of those, but if I missed anything out of that giant list and there's something that you want answered that you can't find in Google, feel free to type it into the comments below and let me know what you're still wondering about mushrooms. So thanks so much for watching this video. I'm Tony from FreshCap.com and we'll see you in the next one. Do you want to become a functional mushroom expert? I've got just the thing for you. It's a new ebook called Mushroom Powered: The History, the Science, and the Benefits of the World's Most Fantastic Fungi. At over 130 pages, it's absolutely packed with all the information you need to know to learn about the world's most powerful medicinal mushrooms. And the best part, it's 100% free. You can download it right now. Just click the link in the description, enter your email address, and I will send it to you right away. I hope you love it.